elsewhere. We objected to it, we complained, got nowhere. Can anybody tell me where, how, why or when this city is going to make any progress whatsoever if we don't back the stay in the union, the European Union? We won't get help off the government. And the long list of stuff that you just put there before, this doesn't look like you just disagree a little bit with what we said about Speak Airport. What you're actually saying is you want them to do what Cameron wants, is renegotiate everything before we agree to stay in. It's typical of a lot of the things that the Greens put forward. We agree to get a principle, but just this one little point, and 25 minutes later, you're still listing what it is that you want to change, which fundamentally changed everything you said in the first place. The reality is, Liverpool would not be in the position it's in now if it hadn't been for European funding. Not central government, European. European funding, much funded by private sector to keep a lot of progress going forward. And we have seen increases in jobs. We've seen reductions on the docks in a number of people employed, but we've seen increases in the different industries in dockers, reduction. Different industries coming in, using it there and creating jobs. So there's a netting input of jobs. And I think that the sooner we realise that this city benefits, and it's about what it does for us, not what it does for everybody, which we take in a general purpose, but Liverpool are not the only ones that suffer with the government. And pulling out of Europe will make it even worse. And it's no good saying we're a member of the Commonwealth and we can deal with the Commonwealth. Do you think there are not trade embargoes and trade differences and people keep quoting about Oslo and Norway and Sweden does that? Do you think they just developed that overnight? It took them years and years of arguing when the European free trade area was abolished. All of that had to be negotiated and settled between them. And they all suffered. It's settled down now and things are moving. But we would have exactly the same. And one of the biggest losers will be the North West and the industrial towns. Shipbuilding was decimated by Katya, and she's done it by getting a grant off the European community to pay people off and do away with jobs. It lost thousands of apprenticeships, it lost an industry, and it lost the skills, which were highly paid jobs, to this country. She didn't just do it with that, she's done it with everything else she could get her hands on. European participation has benefited us. Let's stay there and keep the benefits going.
Councillor Connor, out of your plan.
I'd just like to thank people for their comments. I think everything's been covered. Thank you.
So voting is on the amendment. All those in favour? All those against? Voting is for the amendment 4, against 60, abstentions 0, the amendment is lost. Councillor Radford.
I have a further amendment if I may, and can I apologise to members, I didn't get all the details in time to circulate, so I'll read carefully. I'm sure it's going to be voted down, but I think there has to be a different point of view expressed. I'd like to move an amendment that after the line in the last paragraph says economic benefits to residents of Liverpool, it reads economic benefits and costs to the residents of Liverpool. And then add the following. Britain pays the EU considerably more than it receives back. Britain will make a net contribution to the EU budget of £10.4 billion this year, up from a forecast of £9.5 billion in March. Next year it is expected to pay £9.5 billion compared to the previous forecast of £8.2 billion. Britain is now the second largest net contributor to the EU budget, a fact that EU leaders should stop ignoring when they debate Britain's call for renegotiation. For every £1 received in Merseyside, the taxpayer has spent £2.22. It the UK pays £2.40 for every pound as the UK we receive back. The UK is the fifth largest economy and in the world by GDP, and is the top 10 manufacturing countries in the world despite the fact the EU has significantly damaged our fishing industry, common agriculture, fisheries pond. EU has rules that have affected our steel industry, energy prices, climate change act. Manufacturing, EU's £8 billion incentive for Ford to move plant from Southampton to Turkey in 2012. The procurement laws force UK government to award the contract for building trains from Crossrail to German company Siemens at the expense of Bombardier and Derby. Outside the EU, we could rebuild those industries. Britain leads the world in many other aspects despite EU membership. Education, UK is home to many of the most notable global universities and research institutes. Legally, in legal law, British common law approach and legal ideas have been admitted all over the world, dating back to Magna Carta. Science, two British first scientific companies on the top 10 globally. Technology, 17 of the top 49 European technical companies are based in the UK. And I have given a little note. Can I apologise, and I'm sure it's going to be unpopular, whatever the details are, but I don't think all the arguments are lopsided about Europe. I do accept Europe has done things for this city our own government has not done. There's a problem. We get the government we elect as a country. There is a problem. We don't elect the European. There's been an argument put today that somehow the European Union has prevented World War I and World War II. I would respectfully disagree fundamentally. NATO has prevented a Third World War, not the European Union. And the Marshall Plan, which was largely driven by America, prevented a repeat of the mistakes of World War I. Neither were particularly linked to the European Union. We have had a debate about the Commonwealth, and it has damaged European Union's name. We turn our backs on many of our European, many of our former Commonwealth countries. Europe is one of the lowest growth parts of the global economy. Britain's trade with Europe is only 10% of our national trade abroad. In many ways, you can put up the argument, Europe holds us back. Europe has insisted we have to have liberalisation of industries which don't take place in other countries. So many of our assets are now owned and the profits go out from the UK to overseas. If we're going to have a debate as a council on the European Union, then it's wrong if we're just having the benefits without the costs. I would like someone to guide us. If the motion, which I have absolutely no doubt is passed today, despite the amendment, like trying to put the counter view. If we do, will Liverpool City Council be registering with the Electoral Commission as a campaigning body? What will be the rights of employees of the council who may wish to individually campaign against the European Union? And what will be the position for schools and libraries who are accessing people who might put a different point of view than pro-EU? I think we do need to think our through. If we are going to campaign as a council, and I respect people's right to do so, we have to think of the legal consequences and what are the rights of those of us in the workforce or the council, and the council facilities being used by people who have a different point of view.
I just asked the Chief Executive to clarify something.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. On that latter element, all I'd say at the moment is premature until we know what the shape this is actually going to be in terms of any campaign in favour of staying. There is no rules announced campaign, so there's no rules around that as things stand. And we're still some way off, of course, in terms of the dates and the arrangements to become clearer. On the note that Councillor Radford handed earlier on in this evening's meeting, we're not in a position to substantiate whether any of the numbers that you've put in there are or not. So with respect, I would suggest that we take out the number references because we would publish the essence of what you're saying as part of the record of the meeting and it's being recorded on camera. So we need to be very careful about this if we're actually reiterating something that we don't have control of the authenticity of the numbers or not.
So I respect that guidance. I would still want to move them because they have been validated by the research unit and I'm sure they're going to be defeated anyway. But that's the view I believe in good faith. and I prefer to move them in that basis.
So, just to be clear, Lord Mayor, we would like to remove reference to any company names or any specific around. It's that type of that. Thank you. So it's the editing of the spirit of the literals that would cause a problem for us without diluting the spirit of what you're intending to move. And beyond that, Chair, it's clearly a matter for the council.
Councillor Kemp, then the Mayor. Councillor Kemp.
I strongly suspect that at least once in this council meeting, the Mayor and I will agree on this, because I must say I've never heard such a load of claptrap in all my life. I would like to congratulate Councillor Connor on her maiden speech. It was cogent, it was principled, it was to the point. Of course it is right that in Liverpool, where we've been in such great recipients of Objective 1, we should look closely at what that meant for our communities, our businesses, our community groups, our infrastructure. But she started off, in my view, in entirely the right place. Europe, to me, is a principle. I never visit Europe. I live in Europe. I am European. I might go to Spain, I might go to France, and the way I might go to London, but I live in Europe. I wake up in Europe almost every morning. So do we know precisely whether our European involvement stopped wars? No, we can never prove that, because it's far more complex than that. But when I go to meetings and when we get people here from Germany, and let's just remember the Battle of the Atlantic celebrations, when there were flags from 16 navies paraded through the Anglican Cathedral, and ships from the 16 navies were down at the Albert Dock. The German flag was paraded in the cathedral. The first ship you saw was a German ship. We haven't forgotten, but we have put it behind us, as together we have forged a new Europe. But if we're going to be absolutely mundane about it, let's look at trade. The United States of America have already indicated that if we leave Europe, the trade negotiations going on between Europe and the United States, which currently include us, will have to be renegotiated. And we're not their highest priority. Just look at what the universities say about research, not only about the money they get from Europe, but the collaboration that they can do because they're part of Europe. I'm not uncritical of Europe. I think there are things that they could do better. I think that sometimes there's a little too much bureaucracy. But let's not niggle about small points. The principle is that Europe has been good for our city. It's been good for our country. If we don't get it, this council will suffer and so will our people. Let's get behind the European movement and say just what those facts are, to say that we belong and to say we are passionate supporters of Europe, because they have been passionate supporters of us.
Mayor Anderson.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Just very briefly, the motion calls on the Chief Executive and officers to look at the impact of European Union funding for Liverpool over the period that has been in place. Clearly, it will provide information that, in my view, will be totally accurate, factual, and it will show clearly and demonstrate the evidence of what ERDF, ESF, and the European programmes itself was established to do. That was to offer a helping hand to cities, countries that are the poorest within Europe. That principle is something that most of us, especially those that believe in the principles of offering support and help to people, still we hold dear. So that report, when we get it, will enable us to actually accurately say what we've had and how it's benefited the city. Some of the facts that we've heard today about the Arena and Convention Centre, the bus station, our roads and our infrastructure, and many, many other things, countless other things in terms of infrastructure, but also in terms of the ESF programme itself, how it helps people transform communities, support communities, and help people back into work. All of those things, we need the evidence to see. I was interested, I seen you chatting away to Paul Luttle on Sunday, and strange bedfellows you made, not literally, strange bedfellows you made in terms of at the Remembrance Service. Now you're on it, of course, that at the Remembrance Service, where, as Councillor Connor pointed out, it's because of the fact that we've got a European Union, and whether you like it or not, most people recognise that that rapport, that relationship, that partnership that we have has stopped wars and will stop wars. The facts and the figures what you've produced is just simply fine, absolutely incredible. But there are other principles, forget about the monetary aspect of this, there are other principles that are just as important as to why the economic union of Europe is important, but other figures and other statistics that will prove that the economic benefits are far outweighed by the greater collaboration and support that Europe gives each other. So let's have the debate, but one thing, let me just remind you, one thing that we will not do in the council is concede the fact that this council can't have a democratic debate, reach a conclusion, and then vote on the principle of something and recommend that that is our stance on that. And that's what this council will do at the right juncture and at the right place with the right information, not just UKIP's information, but our own information, backing up the benefits of belonging to the European Union. On all the information.
I have no other speakers, so therefore I'm going to move to the vote. And we'll vote on the amendment. So all those in favour of the amendment, please show. All those against? Any abstentions? For the amendment 2, against 62, no abstention, the amendment is lost. And we go to the main motion, the substantive motion. All those in favour, please show. Against? No abstentions? Same voting?
Yeah.
Motion carried, thank you. Can we move on now to motion 16? Councillor Crone, please. I invite Councillor Crone to move the motion of his name.
Best decision made tonight.
Is that unanimous?
Yes.
Can I advise that in accordance with Standing Order 7.2, agenda items 17 and 18 have been recommended by the LIPs, indicating they have cross-party support. Are these motions now agreed?
Yes.
And for information only, the cross-party motions relate to items 17 and 18 have been referred to the select committees. Can I, before we finish, can I just place on record my thanks to all the members for their behaviour during tonight's meeting, and especially for the excellent contributions of all the councillors who've made their maiden speeches. Councillor Kelly's can I just thank you all, and can I formally now close the meeting? Thank you.